Really well made. Schon wieder some minor disturbances, but one thing I need to mention about this campaign, they really got the immersion right and how it is brewing up. So we tracked a Soviet missile submarine, a ballistic submarine towards the White Sea. And sound check. A ballistic submarine towards the and yeah, war becomes more and more likely. We of course trying to keep tensions low, but it looks like the Soviets preparing for an all-out war. Hey Ruck, you mentioned, I read your last comment in the last stream, that it is unlikely, that it would be more likely that they would deploy below the ice cap, which sounds reasonable. But why in the White Sea? I can't remember the book. I remember there was something of aerial reconnaissance that they photographed bases which tipped them off that something is wrong. Perhaps a lot of submarines were away and then they noticed, okay, something is wrong. No, wait. Ah, is it the same mission? No, it's a different mission. And okay, so in the book, the Soviets putting boomers into harbors and something that confused NATO a lot. Exactly. I remember from the book there was something about aerial reconnaissance, that they made photos, and it was, I think, this Ryan character, which Jack Ryan, I think he, isn't it Jack Ryan who plays also a part in Red Storm Rising, this Clancy character that is present in a lot of books. They are doing this in preparation for the war because they don't want to use nukes in the war. Yeah, I remember, and that is quite likely because many people think if war would have happened, it would be all-out nuclear war. No, it is quite authentic to believe that the war first would have being a conventional war with both factions not eager to launch nukes. What would be possible is if one side would be pressed too hard that they might use tactical nukes, something like Davy Crockett systems, smaller nukes. But both know in the late in this era, both basically had this MAD strategy, mutual assured destruction. That if you launch a nuclear attack, you can believe that the enemy will launch as well, and both will kill, get both nations or both factions will be killed, in an, or even the world will be devastated in an absolute nuclear war, because both had enough nuclear weapons to devastate them each other.
Radio. Recommend you copy the broadcast.
Okay, let's copy the broadcast. Let's go to shallow depth and raise. We are still close to enemy territory. Nothing on the sonars, nothing on the high frequency. Let's expand the wire, but first wait for reaching the depth. Red Storm Rising has no Jack Ryan. Ah, okay. It's one of the few standalone books. Yeah, I remember somebody in the book was bringing up those aerial recon photos and mentioned something about the submarines being in the bases there, and they're doing it in preparation. Yeah, they don't. Something was about those photos and submarines being in the bases. And yeah, why would the Soviets try to deploy submarines into the White Sea in order to keep them safe from killers, from killer submarines? I mean, because in this mission, it seems the Soviets deployed their ballistic submarines towards the White Sea, which seems to be a safe haven in order to have a bargain ship. Because I think in this timeline, most ballistic submarines are equipped with ICBMs, which can basically reach every target on the world, no matter where they are standing. Yeah, Russian White Sea is. I think it's probably Red October you're thinking of. Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. Yes, White Sea is Russian backyard, inaccessible for US subs. It's essentially home base. So I guess they want to keep them safe because they are not stupid and they know that a lot of those ballistic submarines are prone for hunter killers or killers, yeah, hunter, whatever you want to call them, for US submarines killing them in case of war. And if they don't want a nuclear war, it would be a wise choice to deploy them to a safe haven, because you always have this bargain chip of ICBMs launched from nuclear submarines. As I said, early ballistic submarines had only the limited range, but I think by this time frame they were equipped with ICBMs and can basically fire from everywhere. Sure, the alert time is higher, as it would be, of course, more sudden if you launch, let's say, in front of the US coast. They couldn't react to it. But still, I guess nobody would take chances. And before you lose them, and before you get to them to the US coast, you need to get them into the Atlantic. That's not that easy. One big thing is the Sossus barrier between, yeah, near Iceland. I think I remember in the book, that's also a part where they killed a lot of submarines, the Sossus barrier near Iceland. And a lot of Soviet subs got nuked there. And yeah, that's something I didn't like about the book, is that the Soviets lost so many assets in those stubborn attacks. Also in Germany, I remember a lot of those tanks got wasted by everything, by the Bundeswehr, by the US Army. I like reading books about where the enemy is really a strong, dangerous threat. I remember this one part where they nuked the aircraft carrier with Bears, with those aircraft twos, Tupolevs. Okay, are we, yeah, okay, we're on hide, let's copy broadcast. But I know, in the book always the Russians were somewhat the stubborn, low technology, Blerzucker Nachui push guys. And I know also other critics think there's some chauvinism going on in the book, but it is, I mean, is it unlikely? Nobody can say. What would have happened if the Russians really would have pushed into like this? Perhaps they would. I mean, it is not unlikely. It is very likely from nowadays perspective that they would have been holded in Germany, despite their tank advantage, which wasn't, yeah, and especially in the 90s, their advantage wasn't that big. We're talking about a late Cold War, where the advantage of the Soviets was not that big anymore on a conventional warfare. And it seems in the book they are even not planning to conquer Europe or whatever, they just need a diversion. Basically, like the Japanese did in World War II with fighting the US. They never planned to beat them into submission, but only needed time. Conduct all sensor surveillance of approach to Kolo Fjord. Identify and report all Soviet naval movements into and out of Northern Fleet bases. Execution. Weapons attacked. You are not authorized to enter Soviet territory. Orders remain undated. Blah blah. Okay. Good. Soviet Fjord. What Fjord? What? Wait. Kola Fjord. Kola Fjord, you say. Kola Fjord is here. Okay, let's go. We won't enter Russian waters. We will simply. Exactly. That's way more realistic because some of the standard campaigns ask you to go, I don't know, and remain inside of 3 nautical miles of the target. That's absolutely unlikable. Especially if you following submarines with towed array, that would be absolutely crazy to trace submarines that close. I like this campaign is doing it more realistic. Good, stream away, retrieve the floating wire, and then we can go deep. Let's check the depth. You can see it here, 700 feet, that's great. Let's check the layer, 400. Finally, we have a layer. It's, oh, right. In the book, they also use converted fishing trawlers for intelligence purposes. Okay, I don't agree here. And Redstone Rising in particular, so it's a pretty evenly matched with the US. Yeah, like I said, I read the book when I was very young. Somehow I perceived it to be quite a US story about heroism. Blasting everything away that the Russians bring there. And the Russians only are achieving Pyrrhic victories. Which means, yeah, there are some dramatic moments where the US lose stuff, but after the Soviets, I don't know, wasted a lot of assets, but perhaps I have a wrong memory. And it's told from both perspectives. Yeah, I remember there was some guy that was active sonar. Yeah, active sonar, CR1, but I didn't hear it, so it must be far. But I remember it was always somewhat, I perceived it as somewhat stereotypical, but like I said, it's extremely long since I read the book, and it's actually pretty neat. The Soviets inflict a lot of casualties on the US with the backfire bombers. The Iceland assault is a huge success. They're taking ground in Europe. Clancy is writing pretty E sometimes, but yeah, Clancy, I mean, it's fine, you know. Clancy was not some Goethe, and nobody needs a Goethe when writing stories about this. And as I mentioned, back in the days there was no internet. Nowadays you can research everything. So you need to give credit to this guy to researching it to quite a good extent, quite authentic extent, because in the 90s there was no information present. You had to read really books or approach officials. By the way, I recommend you read The Red Army by Ralph Peters. It's a great book told by the other side of World War III. You know, such a text like just human waste with no supports have become meaningless since the machine gun appeared. Yeah, I mean, some of those human wave attacks, if you want to call them like this, still happened in World War II. I mean, World War I already had machine guns, like the, even proper machine guns, like the, what was it, MG-15? And the Maxim, of course. And the Gatling gun, and, no, not Gatling, yeah, what was it, the Gatling, called, whatever. But if our enemy is completely exhausted, and exhausted on in a psychological state and on a supply, when it comes to the supply aspect, and you have infinite, not infinite, but you have a lot of human resources, you know, I wouldn't do it, but sure, some commanders, Soviet commanders might did it in World War II, and human wave attacks were still a thing, for example, in Iraq-Iran war is a great example of human wave attacks. You can read upon it on Wikipedia or some books. I think there was still a lot of human wave attacks commenced, but true, the success was of course limited. They simply killed people because they had no other ideas. I think that's the last example of true human wave attacks, the Iraq-Iran war. I don't know any recent war where they did stuff like this. Simply throw bodies at the enemy. Which is, of course, we can be all happy that we didn't have to participate in shit like this. The Iraq-Iran war is not often mentioned in, it's not that popular, nobody cares. Most people care on for Gulf War or whatever, but the Iraq-Iran war was also a gruesome war. not much gained by both sides, but both nations managed to absolutely destroy themselves by putting so much resource into this goddamn war, while Western nations supported each other. This was a, yeah, some of those, yeah, you can't call it a proxy war, it was not a true proxy war, but yeah, it was a strange war. Unnecessary human lives wasted all over the place. Okay, layer death is 400, let's get close to it. I might go quickly expand my ESM. Nah, let's do, you want to play it? Yeah, let's play it realistic. In, you wouldn't go periscope death if you don't need to, because the danger is way too high. Let's go 300.
Make my depth 3.
Yes, modern submarine commanders are still trained to operate and do everything like World War II commanders did, manual calculation and everything, but periscope depth is, for a modern submarine, is like, yeah, surfacing in broad daylight in front of the British mainland for a German submarine. Being near the surface is extremely dangerous for a modern submarine because of the technology of ASW. So we won't do it, even if I like sometimes to get my periscope out. And even if this game allows you to do it, but we won't do it. Okay, we have some contacts. Check what this is. First check if we have... I always recommend to check first Sphere and Hull, because they don't have a ambiguous contact. With this you can easily confirm, but we don't have anything here. Okay. These are multiple ships. 190, no, what is this? 200, 225, 225. 225 is here. I think that's the fast contacts, the true contacts are on the other side. So here. This would make more sense. Yeah, no, 330 doesn't make sense. 330. No, it doesn't make. What the heck? Are we turning? Yeah, we're turning. The total array is turning.
Sonar,
that's.
I have a new contact. Bearing 154. Designated Sierra 4.
Okay, let's check where do we have the contacts. They are now blind spotted. And we have a lot of active intercepts coming from the east. Speed up to 10.
Make turns for 10 knots, maneuvering on.
Yeah, if those four guys are coming for me, I don't know if I want to stay here, but the TMA might be not correct right now. We will see. I don't hear active intercepts, so they might be far away. But what happened to those contacts I picked up on a turret? They are all blind spotted. 180, yeah, this might be Cola. Okay. Let's give me this movement here. Straighten out the turret array. Straightened. Okay, now I pick something up. 290, 290, does this make sense? Oh, 180, 180 makes sense, yes. This makes sense, what the heck? But those contacts are fading, which could mean there is an. Those are the fast contacts. Look at those contacts, they are proper. Those are not. What the heck is this? Fishing boat. Yeah, yeah, sure, it's a fishing boat. Let's designate a tracker.
Sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 137. Designated Sierra 5.
Another one.
Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 124.
Designated Sierra 6. The situation I want is quite difficult right now. Let's track everything and then we will sort it out.
Sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 346. Designated Sierra
290, 290 is on this side, yeah, nah. Where's the other side? Here. 28, 28, yes, that doesn't make sense. 28 makes more sense than 290. 280, 210 might be south. Yeah, total array is threesome brain. Oh, jeez, so many contacts. 1, 2, 3. I don't know, I have three hard to keep track of. Might enable auto crew.
Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 1, 5, 3. Designated Sierra 8.
A lot of 50 hertz frequencies. Frequencies. Which could be subs. The problem is the toad array is always giving you a second a duplicate of every single contact you might pick up. Simply the nature, the physics of it.
Sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 0, 1, 9.
Sierra 7 is tracked. Okay, let's turn and see what contacts turn with me. Yeah, those two contacts, come on. Wait. This makes more sense. M2 is 0-9, right? Yeah. Drop 0-9. You need to keep the same angle from your... I can't describe it in words, but... If your own ship is a mirror... Yeah, okay. 0-7 is also a mirror of those guys, I think. So there's a lot of stuff coming in from somewhere else, but not from Cola. Is this... Do I need to avoid them or track them? Is there anything coming from 180? No. Wait. This is... Yeah, but 1, 2, 3, that's here. Nothing on. Nothing near 180. Except those million contacts.
Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 2, 1, 5. Designated Sierra 1, 0.
Okay, Sierra 10 might be worth to track. Let's see if this contact moves when we move. But I'm really not happy about those guys here coming with active intercept at me. And they stopped transmitting for some reason. Yeah, I might escape to the north if it becomes, if they come closer. Because this is a screen you won't survive. Let's see if this contact is moving with us. Yeah, this is a false contact, I guess. No, it isn't. Yeah, this is a false contact, okay. You can identify false contacts by maneuvering. Force contacts will stay in relation with you. They will move with you. While recontacts will stay on a true bearing. You will often see something like whoop or sudden movement, and then you know it's a fast contact. Let's check for a second below the layer to make sure that there's no submarine. If I would be Soviet, I would go immediately below the layer if I'm exiting the port. Wait for the total array to come below the... Should be now. Check what was the depth. 400, should be fine. Check it. Man, million of contacts. Yeah, we need to prioritize. Our mission is track all surface ships, or what? Yeah, all. Yeah, I might activate auto crew on the sonar because otherwise I need to spend a lot of time here.
Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 160, designated Sierra 11. Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 156, designated Sierra 12. Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 189, designated Sierra 13. Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 2.
Fast contact.
3. Designated Sierra 14.
Should be sold out by the auto crew. He didn't. Yeah, dropped the fast contact. Quite likely. I mean, no question. Sierra 13 is coming from Cola. Okay, I didn't pick this thing up. Good that we have auto crew. So I guess Sierra 12 and 11, they are old. Let's drop them. But they belong to Sierra 13. So Sierra 13, what is this? Let's check it. It is on bearing 194.
Make turns for 5 knots, maneuvering high.
Okay, sonar operator say so. I see it as well here, but it stopped for some reason. And why did all ships stop active intercepting? Really, everybody stopped. Those contacts are 30 minutes old. They could be everywhere. Yeah, Mike dropped them. Because old contacts are not helpful. They will give you a false idea of whatever. Either they turned, I think they turned. And that's why we don't hear them. They do whole active sonar into the other direction. But CR14 is definitely something, so we can deactivate autocrew again. Sonar. Sonar is not even activated, okay. Because I deactivated by... But CR14 is also that old. What the heck? What I guess going on with the water? Ah, okay. Hitting ground.
Make my depth 4.47 feet. Dive on.
Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 19.
What the heck?
Designated Sierra 15.
What's going on? So what else? Ah, we are below the layer. Sure. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's why we lost all those contacts. I forgot about this. Now we have active. Yeah, active is. Okay, I get it. Go 10 to straighten out.
Designated Sierra 17.
Make turns for 10 knots, maneuvering on.
Okay, total race straightened out. Yeah, we were below the layer, that's what I forgot about. Okay, Sierra 13 is old. Drop it. I need you fresh contacts. Nothing. Uh-huh. Okay, let's go towards Cola before we miss some important stuff.
Con sonar, I have a new contact.
What?
Bearing 0, 1,
yeah, that's mirror contacts. Mirror contacts. Yeah, they're moving. Come on. Auto crew will realize it. Yeah, it's. You see, he's removing it.
Sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 2,
The auto crew also manages to remove ambiguous contacts. Just keep maneuvering. Yeah, those two are untrue. Man, these waters are full of stuff. Mamma mia. The whole zone now.
8 designated Sierra 2 8 con sonar avenue contact bearing 0 3 7 designated Sierra 2 9 con sonar avenue contact.
Okay, we're picking something up on 270. That is definitely a target.
5 designated Sierra 3 0 con sonar avenue contact bearing.
And there was something on
7 designated
215 which was accelerating but stopped. CF-36. Oh, mamma mia. What the heck is going on here? CF-36. This is a true contact. Massa 8. Yeah, Master 8 is a true contact. Okay, Master 8. CF-35 is a false contact.
Con sonar avenue contact bearing 204 designated Sierra 37.
But the auto crew will also remove it after time, so. But you can be fast at removing false contacts from the towed array. Just check. It's also source here. TB16, I think, is the towed array. Stop all contacts, because I currently have three issues to maintain situation awareness. It's just 1 million ships. I think that it's older than 10 minutes will be dropped. Okay, now I have an idea. What? Are you sure? Slow down. Prepare torpedoes.
Make turns for 5 knots. Maneuvering on. Sonar avenue contact bearing 193 designated Sierra 38. Con sonar avenue contact bearing 095.
designated Sierra 3, 9. Con sonar, torpedo in the water.
Oh.
Make my depth 4.
Fucking hell. From where is the torpedo coming? 250, launch contact torpedo, 250. Immediately, 250. 250, tube 1, fire. Fucking hell. Change depth. Fucking hell, man. But what the heck is this mission, man? Do I need to observe the complete Russian fleet or what? 1 million ships coming at me. What the heck is this bullshit here? Jesus Christ, man. Millions of ships coming at me. But I will down somebody. Look at this torpedo. What will happen? Fucking hell, man. What is this for a mission? Complete... Tsarist fleet coming at you. Yeah, no, I'm just joking. Everything is fine. Yeah, come on, I'm gonna take this. Yeah. Monitor Russian fleet movement. Uh-huh. Nobody would monitor a movement like this if they are already going crazy like this. Damn it, how can I skip another mission? It was even fired by a... Yeah, I guess it was fired by a Helix. There's nothing at this bearing. Look at this, two more coming in. What is this, a sub rock? Okay. Where is this thing going? It's a nuclear strike. Nah, that's a subrock. I guess a subrock that went malfunctioned or whatever. Ah, no, it's... Yeah, malfunctioned. Okay, yeah. I don't know how to skip this mission. You're operating near the coast, so it's probably aviation as well. Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. Yeah, I mean the mission isn't asking us to observe from here. That's never would have happened. That would never happen that you would bring a boomer here while major fleet operations going on in a hot state like this. But I mean, the mission briefing isn't stating you need to do it. So we would have ventured into deep waters. Let's do it. I guess the mission is not completed. No. Yeah, what I hate about this campaign system is that you really are forced through all missions. But okay. We will might cheese it now in a fast forward. But still, man, at least provide some information. Those vessels are so close by. Is it always so hard for mission designers to give? Yeah, whatever. Let's go through it. Oh, is this here? You have a situation. Have fun with it.
Fox radio. Recommend you copy the broadcast.
Designated Sierra 1. Con sonar. I have a new Dive designated on. Sierra 3. Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 1, 3, 2. Designated Sierra 4.
Make my depth
make
one,
turns for 3 knots. Maneuver
7 feet. Dive on.
Con, radio. New message traffic received.
Is the Cielo aware what our position or was he heading almost directly towards us? Okay. They are not aware that we are here, but they're sending a helo right at our position. Okay, if you say so. And there's another submarine here, a British one. And I think another one was reported. Yeah, those Brits, they have balls. But on the other hand, they're just passing by a civilian ship. There would be a way to skip missions. That is also a second thing that this game desperately needs.
Make my depth 1, 4, 7 feet. Dive on.
So they know where I am, but they deploy exactly 2 helos here. Okay. Mm-hmm. And an aircraft, Ilyushin. Yeah, I know somebody told me you can modify campaigns in the in some ini file. In some ini file for of Dangerous Waters, which might allow you to proceed some annoying missions, but yeah, I don't know exactly how to do it anymore. I can't remember. Yeah, it's one of those intelligence missions which everything is thrown at you, and yeah, see how you manage by either replaying it or spaghetti through the enemy or whatever. And on the other hand, you don't need to stay close. At least it is not like those stock missions or stock campaigns where you need to remain, I don't know, in 3 nautical miles of some specific target, which would be simply absolutely nonsense. So it's fine, you can go out in the seas. That was also mentioned in the briefing, go out in the seas and hide there. So it was not needed to get us ourselves such into danger. Could imagine those missions are even end simply after time trigger. So keep that in mind. Play as you would be the commander, because it's the same with Dangerous Waters. Some mission designs prime you into an unrealistic way to play, because they say something like, yeah, there's somewhere a submarine trail in 3 nautical miles as soon as possible. But this mission only says track movement, but stay away from gravel. So do it, as you would do in reality. In reality, you would immediately get out of this area here if you have stuff like this. Yes, aircraft. We should have put out the ESM antenna, but like I said, and yeah, somebody mentioned it exactly. If you're close to the coast, you always need to assume that there are aircraft in play. Even without checking for ESM, and those guys might even run without radars. They won't even have ESM emissions. Yeah, and we got destroyed by a helo. That's quite evident. I guess which dropped even either dip sonar or sonar buoy on us. But I always check the mission briefings. There's nothing like. There are hidden mission objectives, that's a problem in the game. So you don't exactly know what is important, but normally I think this campaign doesn't come with something like discovered Typhoon class, discovered Delta class, whatever. Okay.
Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 247, designated Sierra 9.
What the heck? Keel is 600 feet.
Make turns for 5 knots, maneuvering on.
But the total ray is on the ground? Are you kidding me? That's crazy. I think you're just supposed to stay in the area undetected. Yeah, I think as well. Don't need to do anything, just stay there and monitor. I think this could be better stressed out in a briefing, especially, I mean, everybody that designs scenarios for dangerous waters should know how many of those vanilla scenarios are resolving. Unfortunately, they often like, you failed your mission, you didn't stay, I don't know, 3 nautical miles from a harbor. And so a mission designer should know that most of our mindsets are primed towards those unrealistic mission goals, those really dangerous mission goals. I think the briefing could have taken a bit more information about simply keep distance, maintain, monitor what you can, but don't endanger yourself without need. Yeah, could be, we need some more information. That is not a proper briefing. I don't know why, but so many fail at writing briefings. Is this really some sort of art? I don't think so. I think writing a proper briefing takes really a little, but I don't know. Yeah, most of them are false contacts. I mean, you can show the proof, you see. The auto crew will work it out with some time, but sometimes they need time. You see, one contact was removed because he realized it is a false contact.
Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 219, designated Sierra 20. Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 19.
There are a lot of reconnaissance missions in the beginning of those of many campaigns. If they would be designed a bit better, they would be really exciting. Without the need to replay in order to understand what they want from you.
1-3-0, designated Sierra 2-3, con sonar, I have a new contact, bearing 1-6-4, designated Sierra 2-4, con sonar, I have a new contact.
So this here, this indicates like,
Make turns for 15 knots, maneuvering high.
Make my depth 4, 4.
Con sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 0, 4, 7. Designated Sierra 2, 9. Con sonar,
launch
I have a new contact.
Aye,
bearing
sir.
2, 0, 3. Designated Sierra 3, 0. Sonar, torpedo in the water, bearing 0, 4, 3. Con sonar, I have a new contact, bearing 0, 5, 1. Designated Sierra 3, 1. Con sonar, I have a new contact, bearing 0, 4, 8. Designated Sierra 3.
Okay. Two torpedoes? I didn't see this. God damn it. The explosion on the decoy, I think I deactivated it. Normally, I think I deactivated the function that torpedoes Hollywood style detonate on decoys. That's the first time. Perhaps it did for some. Don't get spooked if you launch countermeasures or cavitate their home in you on you.
Con sonar, loud explosion.
What do you mean?
2, 2. Con sonar, loud explosion on the bearing of Master 4. Con sonar, loud
okay.
Explosion on the bearing of Sierra.
Akuras singing themselves. Okay, my guys, do whatever you want. I am out of here. You mean remain at slow driving, slow speed, while somebody launches a torpedo at you. Yeah, that can be the worst thing you can do. And if you're sure that this torpedo is coming for you, you need to get out of there. Those torpedoes would have us killed if we wouldn't have evaded, because they were snaking. They would have found us and killed us. And looks like those two Akulas killed themselves. I don't care. Yeah, this mission is again a bit sloppy. Is it always in this campaign a good mission and then a sloppy mission? Why there are three submarines riding like this? I don't think they would be that close. Doesn't make sense, way too dangerous. submarines that close together. Is it simply somebody put everything into the editor he could? Yeah, give me. Okay, now the Russians are mobilizing. They are now mobilizing everything they can find. But looks like this was not really tested. If submarines colliding with each other, perhaps next time keep some distance between the assets. These guys also might collide. I can immediately tell. No submarines would drive in such a formation. It's absolutely way too dangerous for collision. Perhaps it was not a single auto that made the campaign, I don't know, but it appears to me. Because the style is changing sometimes so drastically between thinking, what the heck was somebody thinking, and good design. This also comes with pretty low information, like the second mission as well. In the first and third mission, they were rather informative. Perhaps they don't know exactly where you are and are just shooting at unclear contacts. Yeah, that's true. You always need to check on the intercept screen if a torpedo is coming directly at you. It won't change bearing. The pinging won't change bearing. But if the pinging is coming for you, you need to get out of there and launch a counter. I think the best, also authentic, real-life tactic is to launch a counter torpedo and then get out of there, clear datum. But it's true, I also know from multiplayer that some people launch torpedoes simply for seeing what happens. You can fire a torpedo and see if this is basically recon by fire, and then you shouldn't get spooked, but this was clear that this is extreme danger. If you know the torpedo will miss you, just hit it out. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, in this case, hit it very, perhaps.
What?
Oh. The Brits are getting engaged. That's a good example for this. Look at this. The torpedo was deployed far away. Now the skies launch an active decoy, which might tip off the enemy where they really are. And this surface vessel, this sub is launching sub rocks too far. So is the war now hot? And you can even, I told it in two videos ago, by force decoy deployment, you can home in the torpedoes into your location. Look at this. It homed into one decoy, now it homes into the second decoy. And if it, look at now what happens. Yeah, okay, it's circling. And this guy, okay. Yeah, he needs to maneuver. He needs to beam it. That's doesn't make sense, really. Because even if he might pick up the decoy, after he passes it, he will acquire you. Yeah, good night, Great Britain. Ah, it's a German submarine. Is it the Germans? The Germans are the only ones that manage in an exercise to kill a US carrier without anybody noticing. So the Germans hold the record in silent submarines. I think after that the purchases for German submarines increased. Yeah, in a simulated exercise they managed to sink a US carrier. Pretty good. Jesus Christ, this guy's getting sub-rocked. Disappeared. Yeah, I need to check the settings. Is it enabled that decoys Take it. No, I don't think so. They would explode. They simply run out of fuel. Yeah. For example, you could write a briefing like, we suspect this and that is stationed at Kola. This and that is currently being observed, operating in the area. Some information like this. So read that hard to put it in a good briefing. This is absolutely crazy if you imagine this. We playing in truth mode, but without truth mode. It's strange that the Russian submarines don't coordinate with each other. Yeah, I mean, if you're submerged, you can't coordinate with each other, really. But they shouldn't run that close. That's absolutely not, won't happen, I think. I mean, what is it? 500 yards from each other? And that's why stuff like this collisions happens. But perhaps somebody knows more and says, nah, that's absolutely authentic that submarines operate between each other submerged 500 yards away. Okay, give me a mission accomplished. Fine. We had some. The British submarine disappeared. I guess they didn't make it. And why in the first place was this British submarine operating here? I mean, never would happen. Do you think the British would deploy a submarine right on the coast of Soviet Russia when a war is upcoming? It is suicide. I mean, think it through. I don't think this was in a book. Never it was in a book. Because it's simply stupid. It doesn't add anything to the game. Deploy the British submarine here and good to go. I don't know. Somehow this gives me the impression this campaign was made by two different guys. Because some of those choices are absolutely nonsense. British submarine operating right in front of Kola on the coast. Sure. Whatever you say. I have nothing better to do. Coming from a visit from Pechenga, because the British absolutely doesn't value their submarines. I don't think really this is hard to figure out. Always assume, if you place assets, enemies, assume why they are there, what is their plan, what is their plan B, something like this. I said, so many war games are so, Arma 3 is a best example for it, suffer from bad mission design, that's absolutely crazy. Because people simply, I don't know, shoot 100 guys gallery. Yeah, you really need to get away from them because they're coming at you as. It makes sense to deploy fast attack subs by this coast since air spotters essentially. It's strange the rush to. According to the Red Storm Rising novel, the Russians train their crews to operate in Wolfpacks. Yeah, Wolfpack is something different. Wolfpack, sure, could be possible, but you wouldn't run submerged like this. That is way too dangerous. But whoever, I don't know, perhaps somebody will say, yeah, I was in a submarine force of the Soviets, and we exactly rided 500 yards away from each other, submerged in a formation. And yeah, diesel submarines, sure, I mean, that was a British diesel submarine, yeah, but Not in a situation like this. That wouldn't happen. Wouldn't happen. Because it makes sense to have them near the coast, but not in surface waters with depth of 200 feet or whatever. And then waiting to get torpedoed by ASW assets. On the way, this might be possible through another telephone connection. I think it's ultra high frequency or something. Yeah, ultra high frequency is something which people use to communicate with submerged submarines. That's true. It could be possible that submarines can communicate with each other. Still, I mean, tell me the tactical advantage from running a formation that is that close. There's none. Perhaps masking yourself? No, I don't know. And it's fine if you can pull it off, but as you see, there was two submarines colliding. Exactly what happens if you put together close submarines? You could say, yeah, happens. I never heard of submarines running that close together. And yeah, might be some secret Russian tactic, I don't know. I don't see any tactical advantage of doing it. Perhaps masking yourself from, I don't know. Could be. I'm not an expert. It makes they built to be extremely stealthy. You mean these are submarines? The Russian formation is bullshit in this case. Yeah, I mean, it's fine if it works out, but as we've seen, two collided, and that is simply bad mission design if stuff goes south like this. I mean, you could say it happens in reality perhaps as well, but they wouldn't work like that. It was a bug, but submarines have collided before in real life. Yeah, that's true. I mean, so I can't help. Perhaps it's on purpose, but I think this mission is somewhat one of those classical dangerous waters. Do intelligence, but don't get yourself suicided missions. We're running 20 knots. I almost can't get away from those guys here, which are coming at me at 15. Yeah, 15. Okay, that's fine. That's not a challenge. That's simply when you realize what is going on. And I've seen others playing missions like this. They blow up or get a mission failed and then replay it and then they manage it. What the heck is the challenge of it? The last mission was, I think, fine. It was not realistic. It was still way too dangerous, but it was fine. And yeah, this British submarine, sorry, but we're talking about human beings that want and are really important asset of the British. They wouldn't broke it like this. Somewhere near the Russian coast, near a major naval base, and wait what happens. It's basically asking for getting killed. Guess this was simply placed for drama. Somebody was thinking, okay, it's likely that torpedoes will be launched at those British, and then the player might freak out or whatever. Perhaps stay more with the reality, and that's the best drama you can get, not this artificial drama. Okay, can we finally get... There would be at least some flare messages or something, but... Yeah, I think the mission will finish soon, and well, for the British Soviet Northern Fleet is great danger, so they send their submarines to keep abreast of all movements of the Soviets. Yeah, you can keep track of the movement, but you do it like here. That is absolutely insane. In shallow waters, sitting in front of a Russian major naval base, what do you expect? Would do it something like here, where you have a lot of options. You survey ships can be tracked from far away. Submarines, sure, it's a bit difficult, but This absolutely makes no sense here. But yeah, everything is possible. I mean, we can, there's no yes or no, because this is a hypothetical scenario. We never know what would have happened in reality. Fortunately. But I think those British here, they were suicide. This was a kamikaze sub. When I enabled truth mode and I saw the British submarine, I immediately know this thing will blow up. And a trained submarine commander would do the same. This is a classic example for an asset simply deployed for player entertainment. Not thinking about why is a British submarine here, what is the job of it, how it plans to survive, what is the plan B of it. That's how I would say is genius mission design, is to think even about AI assets. What is the mission of it? This Russian Soviet submarine, the mission of it is to get to break loose into the sea without getting noticed, without getting destroyed. How would it manage it? What is the option of the submarine? Yeah, we're observing the fleet, I mean, without truth mode, we're observing them, so everything fine. I'm running auto crew. We are tracking them. Looks like, let's take a look at what is going out here. To get back into the game. So, a Russian aircraft carrier sorting together with this carrier group. That is not good news. Tons of submarines. In a tight formation, three submarines. It could be also for masking purposes. If you try to long range establish a contact on them and they're riding a close pack as this, it might be hard to establish how many submarines it is. So I can't say, perhaps it is a valid tactic to run like close like this. And if it works out, it's fine. I just saw those two Akulas colliding with each other. But who knows? Then we have more ships coming out. Looks like a Kyo class is keeping the datum safe. Diesel submarine, one of the popular ones. Beside the German submarines, this might be the submarine that is also in service of a lot of nations.
Make turns for 10 knots, maneuvering high.
Con, sonar, I have a new contact. Bearing 2, 5, 6. Designated Sierra 6, 3.
The British submission isn't sub, is the same as yours. I want to tell the same rock agreed with you. Okay. We did it. Okay, fine. Check the next mission. After one I don't like. A good one, are you sure he comes? Ah, yeah, I saw this. Yeah, this is a special mission. It's about Iceland. Yeah, but we will play it. I mean, I have no other chance. I don't know how to... I remember this mission. From a stream or something. It is somewhat special, but we will play it. It is basically depicting the events of Iceland... of the Iceland invasion. Because Iceland played a major role in a possible World War III conflict. As it would enable the Soviets to base aircraft there and to hit those vital Atlantic convoys and of course also serve as an operation space in order to hit the Western European coast or to contest the Atlantic and of course to disable the Soyuz barrier and whatever. So Iceland was always considered an important target. Do it, yeah, sure, we will play it. We will play it. And I will do a short break of five minutes. And then we will get on the P3. I really love the P3s. I love those aircraft. Please, if there are mission designers seeing this video, do a campaign, please. There are so many ideas left untouched for Dangerous Waters. Do a campaign for the P3 or for the MH-60 and especially for Soviet submarines. I mean, there is a standard campaign, but it is really not that great. And Red Alert has some campaigns, but campaigns for the Kilo class, never done. Man, the Kilo, small sub, diesel sub, not those high-tech stuff. Or the Akula, really love the Akula, the Russian Akula, and suddenly, unfortunately, there are not many campaigns for the Akula. I think I can only think of one. The standard campaign, yeah. Oh wait, there's another one I played in Subcommand. This novel campaign where you are a Russian captain. It's also based on a novel called, I think, what was it called? I played two. One was not that good, Kilo option. The campaign was not that good. But there was another campaign. It's a bit fictional, a bit fantasy, but it's a cool idea. Where you basically play a Soviet submarine commander. And another Soviet submarine commander is going rogue and wants to launch a hardline strike on the whatever Western forces or even on Russia itself. And you are the only one that can prevent it. And it is a Russian versus Russian sub showdown. That was a great campaign. Did I play it here? No. I think it was a Subcommand campaign. I think you can offer them this on the forums if it is still active. Yeah, I mean, it's... If somebody and one good campaign, of course, was you can also find it on my stream. It's a hard campaign. It's the Chinese versus Chinese campaign, the what was it called? Leo Option Doctrine? Leo Doctrine. I have a complete playlist on my channel. That's a great campaign, but this might be even better, we will see. It is not about being better or worse, it's about enjoying it and... Yeah. Give me 5 minutes and then we will fly the P3 over Iceland. Keflavik. And see what happens. I think now it's finally time that the war will get hot.